Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. Over the last few segments, we've been talking about inventory, why it's important, how it gets tracked, the methods that are available both for periodic and perpetual and LIFO and FIFO and weighted average, all these conceptual ideas with inventory. We've done a few calculations with cost of goods sold and also talking a little bit about how errors in inventory will affect net income, but now it's finally time to start making some calculations. Now, unfortunately, we won't get to do any journal entries. I know, I'll pause for the sigh of despair, but we do get to build some tables, and it's almost as much fun. Not quite, but almost. So let's go ahead and jump right in to our big example. Here's the information for our company that has done a bunch of purchasing, they've sent some stuff back, they've sold some items, and we get to keep track of it and decide what their inventory is worth. And we're going to start with a periodic inventory system and how it would record or calculate ending inventory and COGS for FIFO, LIFO, and weighted average. Let's get started. So we're going to build, like I said, a table. We're going to put in three columns. We're going to put in the date first, and then we're going to do our purchases. We're going to make that a big column so we have plenty of room. And then we'll have our inventory balance. Now, remember with a periodic system, we don't keep track of everything going on. We keep track of the purchases. Purchases, purchase discounts, purchase returns. We don't worry about the sales. Basically, we're going to make the assumption that all the purchases happen on day one of the period, and all the sales happen at the end of the period, on the very last day. With that assumption, it's really straightforward to do these calculations, which is one of the reasons why periodic inventory systems are so popular with small businesses that just don't have the resources to keep track of things as they're actually happening or having a computer do it for them. So let's go ahead and take a look at just the purchases. We're not even going to worry about the sales because we're going to assume the sales happen later. So let's start with our beginning balance. And this isn't really a purchase, but we'll put it here, 10,000 units at $10 each is $100,000. And I'm just going to say all of the numbers that we're using come from the slide that we just left, this slide here. Let's see, our inventory balance then at this point is $100,000 because all I've got is my beginning inventory. The second transaction, we don't have dates on these, but the second transaction is another purchase. We purchased 80,000 units for $12 each, which is a total of $960,000. If I add that to the 100,000, I have 1,060,000 now in my inventory. And again, I'm not worrying about sales. I'm assuming that all the sales are going to happen later. I'm just worrying about purchases. And the next purchase is the fourth transaction, where instead of a purchase, I have a return. So I sent back 30,000 units at $12 each. And notice here, FIFO, LIFO, weighted average, I don't care when I'm doing a return. When I return, I go back to the exact purchase order and I find out exactly what I paid for those items and I record that I sent them back. So I'm not using weighted average, FIFO, LIFO stuff with a return or a discount. I go back to the purchase order and I get the exact number. Because I've had to track them specifically to send them back, I know exactly which units they are. Once I start selling them, they're all a jumble and I don't know. But when I send them back or I get a discount, I do. So this is going to reduce the value of my inventory by 360,000, bringing me down to 700,000 total. The last purchase is number five, 90,000 units at $15 each for a total of 1,350,000, just multiplying the 90 by the 15. And that's going to give me a grand total of 2,050,000. And this number right here, this is cost of goods available for sale. So now let's gather some information, the information that I'd need in order to do a cost of goods sold section on my balance sheet. That'll help us get set up for the calculations we're about to make. So beginning balance was 100,000. Our purchases, let's see, that would be this 960 and this 1,350,000. So total purchases, 2,310. Discounts, there aren't any. But let me just say here, if there were a discount, I would actually come back up to my table and I would change this value or that value, wherever the discount fit in. And I use that new value for all of my different calculations as I move the rest of the way through the process. Next, then we had returns, and we did have some returns. We returned 360,000, and we had no allowances, so we won't worry about that. Allowance, again, is where they reduced the price because it was broken, and rather than us returning the merchandise, they said, hey, just pay a little less and then keep it. Okay, the other thing we need to know before we can really do a periodic system is we need to know the units available for sale. And if I add these up, let's see, I had 10,000 units plus 80,000 units plus 90,000 units minus the 30,000 units, and it comes out to 150,000 units. Next, I need to know the units sold. And to find that, I am going to have to go back to my other PowerPoint slide. So let me go back. So let's see, I sold 50,000. So 50,000, that's this number. And then I sold 35 and 45. So 35,000 and 45,000. And I'm going to treat all these as if they all happened at one time. So see, 50 plus 35 plus 45, 130,000 units that I sold. So of 150,000 units that I either bought or had on hand, I've sold 130. So my units in ending inventory must be 20,000. And I need to know this to do my periodic calculations. So here's my key information. Anytime I'm doing a periodic system, whatever assumption I make, I would get all of these numbers. I need them. I need them for my calculation of cost of goods sold. I need them for my income statement, etc. I need all of this stuff. The difference is my assumption on what 20,000 units are left over in that ending inventory. You see, under FIFO, I assume that I sold all the old stuff and the new stuff is still there. So I'm going to find this 20,000 units in the newest stuff I purchased. Under LIFO, on the other hand, I assume I sold the newest purchases first, so I start with purchase 5, and then I'd move up and sell the older stuff later, which means that if I'm starting with 20,000 units, I'll start with beginning inventory, and then I'll move to the next purchase and the next purchase till I get those 20,000 units. Under weighted average, I'm assuming that I don't care where those 20,000 units come from. I'm just going to add up all my costs, divide by the total number of units, and that's going to give me a cost per unit. So I don't care what order I sold things in. So that's what's different between the three methods. And with that kind of as an intro, let's calculate ending inventory and COGS under each method. And let's start with FIFO. So ending inventory under FIFO, I'm going to assume that those 20,000 units are from the most recent purchase. So that's 90,000 units in that most recent purchase. So that's more than enough to cover those 20,000. So I'm going to assume that all 20,000 are from that $15 per unit purchase for a total ending inventory of $300,000. Next, I want to get my cost of goods sold. And if you remember, that's cost of goods available for sale minus ending inventory. So my cost of goods available for sale is up here, 2,050,000. Ending inventory is 300,000. That's this number. So my total cost of goods sold under FIFO is 1,750,000. Now let's take a look at LIFO and see how it's different. Now I'm assuming that if I've got 20,000 units left, the oldest stuff is still there. So I would start off with my beginning balance, and I had 10,000 units in beginning balance. But that's not enough. I say I've got 20,000 units. So I would move to the next purchase, which in this case is transaction number 2. And I would say, okay, I had 10,000 units up in beginning inventory. And now I'd get another $10,000 to get to my $20,000 from this purchase at $12 each. So we're going to have $10,000 at 10 and $10,000 at 12. And that's going to give us the 20,000 units total. So let's see, that's 100,000. That's 120,000. So total ending inventory under LIFO is $220,000. Cost of goods sold, same as before. We're going to take cost of goods available for sale, 2,050,000, minus ending inventory. Under LIFO, that's the 220. So my cost of goods sold under LIFO will be $1,830,000. And you can see here, this has dropped my net income quite a bit, or will drop my net income quite a bit from what I calculated under FIFO. Last is weighted average. And as we said, under weighted average, we don't care what units are left. We're going to calculate an average cost per unit, and that's going to be my cost of goods available for sale divided by my number of units available for sale. So cost of goods available for sale, again, 2,050,000. Total units available for sale were 150,000. So overall, if we round to the nearest penny, we spent $13.67 per unit on average. So when I calculate my ending inventory, I'm going to take my 20,000 units times that $13.67, and I'm going to get a total ending inventory value. Again, I'm rounding this to the nearest penny. Ending inventory would be $273,400. And cost of goods sold will be the $2,050,000 cost of goods available for sale minus the $273,400, and that's going to give me $1,776,600. Hopefully you noticed a couple of patterns there as we were going through this. Hopefully you noticed that cost of goods sold was higher under LIFO than FIFO. You also hopefully noticed that FIFO gave a better ending inventory, a higher ending inventory than LIFO did. And weighted average, right in the middle of the two. And that's a pretty typical pattern for any inflationary period. Most of the time prices rise. That's what we see usually in the United States. So that's a pattern that holds pretty much true under US GAAP. Now that we've done these periodic inventory methods, it's time to move on to perpetual inventory. And we'll look at those when we come back. I'll see you then.